ভজ গৌরাঙ্গ কহ গৌরাঙ্গ লহ গৌরাঙ্গের নাম রে যেই জন গৌরাঙ্গ ভজে সে হয় আমার প্রাণ রে যেই জন গৌরাঙ্গ ভজে সে হয় আমার
Hare Krishna, dear devotees, and welcome to today's session. How are you doing? I pray that all is well with you and your families at this time. So we're moving on with our summary study of the Chaitanya Charitamrita, which is actually the teachings of Lord Chaitanya. And we'll start with the invocation.
Vande Gurum Isya Bhaktam Isya Isya Vatarakam Tat Prakasham Tat Shakti Si Chaitanya Samyakam.
So it's offering obeisances to our spiritual masters, plural. That's our Shiksha and Diksha Gurus, to Isya Bhakta, to all the devotees of the Lord. Like we say, Vancha Kalpa. And Isya Isya Avatarakam, to all the avatars, and Tat Prakasham Tatat Shaktis, and to all the Shaktis, the energies of the Lord, and to Lord Chaitanya, Sri Chaitanya Samyakam, and to Lord Chaitanya himself. So we're proceeding with our reading. I had fantastic feedback. Thank you so much for your association and your eagerness to wanting to hear about Lord Chaitanya and his study. So originally we planned this for 15 minutes, but most devotees, so many actually, replied and saying, Prabhu, please, 5 minutes more. So we're going to extend our reading for 5 minutes more. So it's going to be a 20-minute reading together as we discuss the beautiful pastimes of Lord Chaitanya. So we're catching the reading in the preface, and we're catching it at this point. The Lord demands that one surrender unto Him by following these 6 guidelines. But the unintelligent so-called scholars of the world misunderstand these demands and urge the general mass of people to reject them. So on first reading, if you read the word scholars, you'll think it's the scientific community or the educational community. Once we read further, we'll see that this scholars Prabhupada is referring to is the jnanis, those whose goal is the impersonal Brahman. And we know by their process, it's rejecting. You remember our definition of uttama bhakti, anya bilashita shunyam, jnana karma anavritam, anukulyena krishna anushilanam bhakti ruttama. That this Uttama Bhakti is free from karma and jnana. So here Prabhupada is immediately defining and separating that the idea of jnana should be given up. That the idea of jnana separate from Krishna, that is not the goal. Because that creates the tendency to want to reject the world. You remember we discussed that in the first introduction. So that idea should be given up, that nothing should be rejected. It's, are we rejecting because we don't find this useful? We don't know, finding something not useful means we don't know what is the purpose of this thing, in other words. So indirectly, he's too proud to say he doesn't know what's the purpose of this world, better just reject it. But the devotee, he understands everything, and his service is symbiotic. He understands that this has a purpose, and if I can connect it to Krishna and it's connected to its constitution position, then I can use it in Krishna's service. So Prabhupada clarifies that point. Another thing we see with the typical of jnanis, although they reject this whole world, there's one thing that a jnani cannot reject, and that is most of them, you see, most of the leadership of the spiritual leadership of today, they're all engaged in seva, service back to humanity. So our question to them is, if you rejected this material creation, Why are you doing seva back to humanity? Why are you serving humanity again? That is a total contradiction of what you believe or what is your goal. You just gave that up just now. You're saying you reject this world and now you want to go back and serve. Service to man will be service to God. The point is you have not put Krishna in the center. You see, you still feel that man and God are equal. They are only equal qualitatively. Quantitatively, we are dependent. Nityo nityanam chaitanas chaitananam eko bahunam jo vitadati kaman. Both are nitya, eternal, the soul and God. And both are conscious, chaitanas chaitananam. But what is the difference? Ekho bahunam jo vitadati kaman. Ekho, but one is dependent on the other. As soon as we understand this principle, nothing to reject. Use it all in Krishna's service. So let's see what Prabhupada goes on to say. At the conclusion of the ninth chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna directly orders, always think of me, become my devotee, worship me alone, and offer obeisances unto me alone. By so doing, the Lord says that one is sure to go to him in his transcendental abode. Now, devotees, this is the most important point in trying to understand who is Lord Chaitanya. There is two verses in the Bhagavad Gita, because one may ask, is Lord Chaitanya described in the Bhagavad Gita? Where is he described? Why Krishna never mentioned him? Because he is Chana avatar, he is secret avatar. But he is also mentioned indirectly, and here's the proof. So there's two verses in Bhagavad Gita where Krishna has repeated himself. 9.34 and 18.65. Both these verses are so important. It's identical except for one line. So he says in those verses, 9.34, Man mana bhava mad bhakto madhyaji mam namaskaro mam evasyasi satyam te pratijana priyosime. And in 1865, it's just the last line that changes. Atmana mat parayana. So identical verses, but what is the meaning of this? So in these verses, Krishna is saying, as Prabhupada has said here, Manmana, use your mind to think about me. Mad bhakto, become my devotee. Mad bhakta, become my devotee. Madhyaji mam namaskaro. Madhyaji, worship me. Namaskaro, by offering namaskar. So he's saying all these things. But constitutionally, if we understand ontologically the nature of God, there is nobody higher than God. God is the supreme spiritual being. There is nobody ontologically higher than God. You can't go higher than that. So Krishna is speaking here about something that he has no experience of. Because what he's speaking here is of a devotee. He's saying, become my devotee, worship me. How does he know what it feels like to worship someone? Because he is the highest. Ontologically, you can't go higher than Krishna. You can't go higher than the Supreme God. So by nature, he never has an experience, or he cannot have an experience of what it is to worship someone, because he is the supreme worshipable being. He cannot have that experience, because if he could, then he won't be the supreme Lord. He won't be the highest God. But he is the highest God. Therefore, by that definition, he doesn't have anybody higher than him. So how does he know what it feels like to worship somebody higher? How does he know what it feels like to offer namaskar to someone higher than him? So do you understand this point? It's a very deep ontological, existential point to know that God is speaking about something that in his own experience he'll never have within himself. Because he is the highest. By nature of being the highest, he will never serve anybody higher than him. So how does he know what it feels like to be a devotee? Because he cannot, by his nature, he cannot be a devotee. So how does he know what it feels like to be a devotee? So this is Lord Chaitanya. Therefore, the topmost devotee we know is Srimati Radharani. Radharani is described in the Vedic literature and in the Srimad Bhagavatam as the topmost devotee. She's not even mentioned by name because she's so special to Sukadev Goswami, who's speaking to Parikshit Maharaj. So the only way Krishna can understand is if he goes into the same body as Radharani and then experiences from being within her body what it feels like to be a devotee, what it feels like to cry like a devotee, what it feels like to offer namaskar like a devotee, what it feels like to think of the Lord all the time. Because he's the supreme object, he cannot think, there is no object superior to him. Aham sarvasya prabhavo matta sarvam pravartyate iti matva bhajante mam buddha bhava samanvitaha. All spiritual and material creations are all emanating from me. Everything is coming from me. Matta paratanannanyat kinchit asti dhananjaya mai sarvam idam prokta sutra manigana eva. Krishna is saying everything is strung upon me just like pearls are strung on a thread. So if he is the supreme object, how will he have an experience of serving someone? Because to serve means they have to be higher. So the only way he can do it is to go into the body of his supreme devotee, which is Radharani. Therefore, this is Lord Chaitanya. Shri Krishna Chaitanya Radha Krishna Nahi Anya. He is non-different from Radha and Krishna combined. So we're getting to understand who is Lord Chaitanya just from Bhagavad Gita. Only from Gita. From Gita, Krishna is explaining this point. It's a very secret point, but see it there. That without understanding this point, you're not going to even conceive of who is Lord Chaitanya. It's Krishna trying to experience the bhav, the deep love that a devotee has for him. Because he cannot be a devotee of anyone. He is the Supreme Lord. There's nobody higher to him. He declares that. Therefore, the only way he can experience this bhav, this mood of being a devotee, is to be in the same body of his devotee. Therefore, Radha and Krishna in one body, this is Lord Chaitanya. This is who Lord Chaitanya is. So by clarifying this point that we're not just worshipping another sadhu, another saint in India, he is Radha and Krishna combined due to this form, due to this most confidential part of the Bhagavad Gita. That's why Krishna repeated this verse twice, to make us think why. It's the Sarvopanishada Gao Dugda Gopala Nandana Parthavatsa Sudhir Bhokta Dugda Gita Amrita Mahat. That this is the essence of all these Sarva Upanishada Gao. Essence of all Upanishads is Bhagavad Gita. And in that now, if he's summarizing all the Upanishads there and he's repeating himself, means this is so important. If you don't catch this, you don't catch Bhagavad Gita. This is how essential it is. So he gives this defining point right there. So I hope this helps us establish who is Lord Chaitanya. He is Krishna trying to experience what the devotee feels in the heart by being one within the same body of the devotee. So Prabhupada goes on to say, but the scholarly demons misguide the mass of people by directing them to surrender not to the personality of Godhead, but rather to the impersonal, transcendental, eternal, unborn truth. So we see this, that this is how the Jnanis explain God. That God is formless, God is some light, is some energy. This is why the Om is so prevalent. So there is no form to God. When God comes down, he comes in the form, he takes an avatar. He comes in a material form. But that's not the fact. What does Bhagavad Gita say? So evidence of this, we're only going to quote from the Vedas, which is from Bhagavad Gita and from Isopanishad. It's not coming from any guru or teacher in his commentary. So this direct from Vedas. What does Bhagavad Gita say? Gita says, Abhijanati ma mudha manusham tanum ashritam param bhavam ajananto mama bhuta maheshwaram. So he's saying, Abhijanati, they don't know, these foolish people, they don't know. Abhijanati, ma mudha, these mudhas, these foolish people, they don't know. What do they don't know? Abhijanati ma mudha, manusham tanum ashritam. They think I took this manush, this human form, I'm taking shelter of this just coming from some energy, from some formless feature. Param bhavam ajananto. They don't know param bhav, my higher nature. Ajananto. They don't know my higher nature. Mama bhuta maheshwaram. I am the supreme lord of all this creation. So he's firstly declaring that don't think I come from some formless energy form. So let's clarify first and foremost that there's two parts to this formless thing. One is the impersonal and the other is the Mayavad. Now the impersonalists, they are more innocent. They are just following because their religion has taught them that God is formless. At least they're worshipping and trying to love. It's so difficult, as we can understand. You say you love the air, you love the light, you know, you love the sky. It's so difficult to love something that has no form. But they are more innocent. The Mayavadis is what we're going to hear about and where Prabhupada really slams down, because these people are simply putting themselves in the center. The primordial existential reason why we are in this material world is because we want to be God. So even in religion, they have brought it in to show that we are one with God. We are God, but we don't realize it. So because of that, Prabhupada slammed down so heavily on Mayavad. When Prabhupada would speak, the early devotees, you can imagine, they were totally flabbergasted. Who is this Mayavad? Somebody said it was Prabhupada's uncle, maybe. You know the Indian uncle story. There must be Prabhupada's uncle or somebody. And then they asked him, who is this Mayavad? Yeah, to start off, they were so innocent. They didn't know. What is this Mayavad? Because it's so prevalent in the world today. Most of religion today, especially like Hinduism and even Islam, Judaism, all of them worship a God, but they say the ultimate goal is to merge into that oneness of God. God is no form. So that's more innocent. The Mayavad is decrying God. God doesn't exist. I am God just having an experience here. I am God just doing my own leela in this world. So Prabhupada would ask then, if you are God, what is the energy that's keeping you here as God? That seems to be stronger than you. So you have God and you have the soul. And the soul comes under the illusion that he's a human being. That means illusion is stronger than God. So it doesn't make sense. So now you don't just have oneness, that everything is one and that I am God. You got two. Because the energy that's covering you, that's putting you under illusion, you have no control of it right now. Change it? You can't change it. Why you can't change it? Because it's stronger than you. Then how you can be God? So they can't explain why they are under illusion. Why illusion is able to control God to make him think that he's a human being. They can't explain it. Therefore, there's three. There's not oneness. There is God. This is Krishna explaining also in 15th chapter, 16th verse Gita. Shara, Akshara and the Supreme Being. So Shara means a conditioned soul. Akshara, the liberated soul. And the Supreme Being. Three kinds of souls there. Not just that we all are one. So Gita is proclaiming this, but the version of Gita that most people are reading is not as it is. Therefore, they're getting illusioned. Then if it's so, explain why the energy is controlling you in this way. So Prabhupada goes on to explain here. The impersonal Mayavad philosophers do not accept that the ultimate aspect of the Absolute Truth is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So they don't accept that God is this, that the supreme aspect of God is form. So let's see what Krishna says in Gita. So for this, we're referring to chapter 12, the first five verses of Bhagavad Gita, chapter 12. So let's see what it says. Chapter 12, verse 1, translation. Arjuna inquired, which are considered to be more perfect? Those who are always properly engaged in your devotional service, or those who worship the impersonal Brahman, the unmanifested? So that's what's our question, right? Arjuna, even that time they had this problem. Even that 5,000 years ago, this problem was also there. So what's the answer? So we've reached our time limit. We're going to stop here, so that please join us tomorrow, as we had a very crucial point in understanding the difference between impersonalism and personalism. Hare Krishna.